The camp of embattled Philippine lawmaker Arnolfo Teves Jr. feels validated by the recent recantations of suspects in the killing of Negros Oriental Governor Ruel Degamo. His legal counsel, attorney Ferdinand Tupasho, says the suspects' claims that they were just forced to drag Teves in the killing proves that the case is based on fabrication and lies. But the Justice Department is unfazed, saying the recantations will not affect the merits of the case. And we have with us this morning to talk about this Senior Deputy State Prosecutor Richard Anthony Fadeleon from the National Prosecution Service of the Department of Justice. Good morning, Prosecutor Fadeleon. Welcome to the program.
Good morning, Mike, and good morning to all your viewers.
All right, Prosecutor, what's the status now of your probe on suspended Representative Arnolfo Teves Jr.? I understand that there was a preliminary investigation the other day. So does this mean this will now go into preliminary investigation? Have you received the affidavits of the so-called recantations?
Okay, first of all, the preliminary investigation of the case as against Congressman Teves and those who were newly charged together with him have not yet begun. No, it's going to start. The panel has just been given the records of the case after it had undergone evaluation. And that's the only time that the subpoenas, if ever, will be issued to all the parties concerned. Now, as far as the hearing or the preliminary investigation that was conducted, I think that was Monday, this was a preliminary investigation involving four of the accused. One of them is Osmundo Rivero, the accused who recanted. And the case was only reopened precisely to give Rivero an opportunity to submit his counter affidavit because he had requested to do so, considering that he had just acquired the services of counsel. For the record, for the record, what we have in the department is a copy of the recantation, affidavit of recantation of accused Rivero. There reports that there are others who would be following him, but thus far, this have remained reports, and we have not been furnished copies, neither have we seen copies of the same.
All right. So, Prosecutor, just to be clear, what happened the other day was a reopening of the preliminary investigation with respect to Mr. Rivero. This is with respect to the murder, frustrated murder, and attempted murder cases that are already pending in court. Is that right?
Yes, that is correct. One must remember that initially these cases were investigated by the prosecutors from Negros Oriental. Immediately after the four accused, including accused Rivero, were arrested on the same day, March 4, 2023, and Rivero, who was arrested, I think, the following day. The investigation in Negros Oriental only involved the complaints of three of those who were murdered, including the complaint of Mayor Janice Degamo for the death of her husband, Governor Ruel Degamo. Thereafter, the cases were ordered transferred to the Department of Justice because there was this fear that the accused in that case, or the primary suspects, would have some influence or would probably exert some influence in their province. So this was transferred to the department. And it is in the department that we began the investigation for the killings of seven others and at least 18 of those who were victims of frustrated and attempted murder charges.
With the statement coming from the lawyer of the four suspects, four accused prosecutor, that three others have actually recanted their earlier statements. They have signed affidavits. I understand you have yet to receive those. Are you also going to reopen the preliminary investigation with respect to the three others who supposedly signed affidavits of recantation?
Well, the funny thing about that, Mike, is that the three others who are supposed to be represented by the same lawyers as that of Osmundo Rivero are not among those who are being investigated in that case where the case was actually reopened. The case, as far as these three, have already been filed way ahead. And therefore, to say that it would be, the case would be reopened as far as they are concerned, would have no basis, considering that the case is already filed in court, and any pleading that they would wish to file in connection with that would have to be with the permission of the court anymore. It's not going to be a matter that will have to be decided by the Department of Justice.
Isn't that the same case, though, Prosecutor, with respect to Rivero? Because I understand Rivero is also facing murder charges already in court.
Yes, Rivero was already facing charges in court. That is correct. But we have to take note that the charges against Rivero like I mentioned earlier, was only or only pertained to three complaints. These were the ones which were investigated in Negros Oriental. Now, when the cases were transferred here, that was the only time when the panel was given copies of the other complaints involving the others who were murdered and those who were the subject of frustrated and attempted murder charges.
Okay. But how significant are these recantations, prosecutor, assuming that you're able to receive them and you're able to reevaluate the cases that have been filed? Is there a possibility, if you find that there's basis really, to withdraw the charges against those who are already facing murder charges in court?
Well, let me put it this way, Mike. If, for example, there is any truth to the allegations, let's say I would like to refer to the affidavit of recantation of accused Rivero, considering that's the one with us. And if it is true what he alleges there, that he had been tortured or coerced or intimidated into coming up with a statement, and if that has to be investigated, then we will conduct the investigation. And if ever it is proven that there is some truth, no, or there's any basis for the charges, then those who are responsible or those who will be identified to be responsible for the same should be made to face charges as well. However, I would like to stress the point that if, on the other hand, it would appear that there is no basis for these charges or these allegations, then Rivero should be made to account for it himself. He should not be allowed to toy with the criminal justice system or toy with the justice system by coming up with changes in his statements without necessarily being able to explain or justify the same. That would hold true for the others. Would it necessarily mean that the case would be weakened already? Not necessarily so. Because his statements, assuming them to be in existence, would only be one part of evidence. That would be testimonial evidence. And we all know that apart from testimonial evidence, well, that is the one which we are more or quite familiar with, there are other pieces of evidence that may be considered by the panel. We're talking about documentary, object and real evidence, and of course, forensic evidence.
But will those evidence be enough to tie Representative Tevez to the killing, prosecutor? Because if four suspects have recanted, assuming that they will push through with the recantation, who else is there to testify? Because Marvin Miranda has been reported to be not cooperating. And the basis for implicating or indicting Miranda in the earlier murder cases is a statement of one particular suspect, for instance, Rogelio Antipolo, who supposedly revealed two prior assassination attempts. And there were certain actions supposedly that were taken, like buying rocket-propelled grenades in Mindanao, using Tevez's helicopter. There were some details, very specific details coming from Mr. Antipolo himself. Without those details, can you still tie Representative Tevez to the murder charges?
Again, let's put it this way. As far as much as I would want to disclose anything pertaining to the investigation pertaining to any liability that may be attributed to Congressman Tevez, I would like to withhold the same for the meantime, considering that the panel is yet to conduct its investigation. And I do not want to preempt any finding that the panel may have or whatever it is or how they will consider the recantations. But I would like to say that at this point, if you have one suspect recanting, or at least four of them, as alleged by the lawyers, there are other accused who still remain steadfast in their statements. And even if, for example, you take that away, if you look at the statements that were made, it doesn't necessarily follow that they will have to testify for that purpose. You just have to look at the statements and the manner by which they were executed, how they were taken, because recantations are not necessarily gospel truth. It doesn't follow that this, just because this is the last statement that you have, this is the truth now. It will still have to be subjected to careful scrutiny by the court to determine first the circumstances as to why the suspect recanted. The court will have to scrutinize also and look into the allegations, which is more believable. It doesn't simply follow, like many think, that just because there are recantations now, the previous statements are altogether done away with. This is something that will still have to go through rigorous scrutiny by the courts. And it is only when the courts would be satisfied that there is no effect on the credibility of the accused, he is able to justify the reason for his recantation, that's the time that it would be considered as something very important. But for now, I would say that just because there are recantations, it still is up to the accused who recanted to show and justify the reasons for the recantation that he made.
The prosecutor, you were quoted as saying that there's still a strong case against Representative Tevez despite the supposed recantations. But there are also concerns from the Tevez camp that this might already be a prejudgment on the preliminary investigation. I understand earlier you said you don't want to comment on the possible liability still because it's still going to go through a preliminary investigation. But when you have the Justice Secretary already saying Tevez was the main mastermind, how does that complicate the work of the prosecutors who are handling this case?
Well, as far as the prosecutors are concerned, they conduct an independent investigation. There's nothing that we can do as far as the statements that the secretary releases to the public. At the end of the day, Mike, what would be determinative here is not what is discussed in the media or the statements which are brought forth in the media. Many think that all these exchanges that are coming out in the media from both sides, for example, would already be the decisive factor in deciding whether anybody is liable, criminally liable or not. I would say that the correct forum or the battleground would be in court because it will be the judge who will be appreciating the evidence that will be brought forward. As far as the prosecutors are concerned, we will be concerned about the evidence that will be brought forward and presented in court. That's the responsibility that our prosecutors would have. When I say that there is still a strong case, this is premised on the fact that many believe that just because there is a recantation, it completely impacts on the case such a way that it totally weakens it. And that is what we're trying to explain to the public, that even if there is a recantation, this is but one form of evidence. And we have been, for the longest time, always been content. We've always been content in just accepting testimonial evidence. If you look at it, there are other pieces of evidence, like forensic, for example, which is based on science, which is something which cannot be questioned. Whereas compared to testimonial evidence, which can easily be swayed, easily be changed, and still, even if it is presented, even if it is the last statement made, one has to look into the veracity, one has to look at the credibility, because any change in statements would affect the credibility of whoever recants or makes changes in his statements without any possible explanation.
All right, so we will wait for that preliminary investigation, prosecutor. What is the timeline for that preliminary investigation? When is it going to start with respect to Representative Tevez?
The preliminary investigation, as far as Congressman Tevez and the others who are charged with him, will have a timetable of about 6 days. This will depend on how the parties, if the parties will cooperate and submit their, counter affidavits, because you have some problems here because of the fact that, it has been reported that Congressman Tevez is not in the country. So yes. I don't know how the panel will deal with that or how the lawyers for the defense will deal with that. Now, we'd just like to see and give the panel all the leeway they need for purposes of conducting the preliminary investigation. But under our rules, you have 60 days to start and terminate the preliminary investigation. We're expecting it to start probably with the issuance of the subpoenas not later than next week.
All right. Prosecutor Fred De Leon, if you will allow us to ask about this earlier item that reported on, I understand that we invited you on the Tevez issue, but there's this other issue about Peter Jomel Vincula or Bicoy, who I don't know if you've already heard, has been convicted yesterday of perjury because of his allegations against three flag lawyers. May we get your reaction first to that conviction, and how will this affect the conspiracy to commit sedition case that were lodged against former Senator Trillanes and others in connection with supposedly the oust Duterte plot?
Well, my recollection does not fail me, Mike. I know that Bicoy was charged for perjury. I also heard in the news that he had been convicted. But I'm sorry, at this point, I would not be in a position to recall exactly the charges in relation there to pertaining to the ones filed as against former Senator Trillanes. I'd have to go back to my records on that for now.
That's all right. Perfectly understandable. We just, of course, wanted to get your thoughts since you're already here. Yeah. And we just reported on the Bicoy issue. But thank you so much for joining us this morning, Senior Deputy State Prosecutor Richard Anthony Fadalion.
Thank you, Mike. And it was my pleasure. Good morning to everyone.